Hello everyone and welcome to our fifth and final episode in the celestial mechanics section as part of our exoplanet detection series here in the Cool Boards classroom. Now so far we have talked about Kepler's laws of motions and 3D orbits, but we've been really framing the planetary motion in terms of this angle F, which is the true anomaly. And that's useful, but it's also a little bit abstract. We tend to think in terms of time more intuitionally. So today we're going to be exploring the relationship between true anomaly angle F and time T. There are actually three results which we are going to be deriving today. The first is going to be how F changes with time, so that's dF dt. The second is going to be how radial position changes with time, so dr dt, or in other words, velocity. And then finally, we're going to be going from time to F, thinking about a procedure to make that change. We'll start though with dF dt. Let's start with the three equations we obtained in video C. These are the specific angular momentum h, the radial distance r, and the true anomaly f. We also know from Kepler's second law that h equals r squared multiplied by theta dot, which we covered in video B. Plugging the three equations on the left into the right, we obtain the following. Now, notice how since curly pi is a constant, then theta dot is equal to f dot. Now let's move the a and the 1 minus e squared terms around a little bit. And now since f dot is df dt, then rearranging this we obtain dt df as follows. We can clean this up a little bit more using Kepler's third law and replacing this orange term here. Doing so yields the following final equation. Now, unfortunately, we can't take this analytic equation for df dt and trivially solve it to get f as a function of time, but we will show a procedure for doing that later in the video. Now, df dt, you can kind of think of it as being like an angular speed, and angular speed is useful, but it's actually more intuitive, maybe more physically useful to think about the actual speed dr dt. So let's turn to that now. Let's clear the slate and keep just these two expressions, Kepler's first law and dt df. Before we can obtain velocity v, we're going to grab an intermediate result that will help us out. First, we can differentiate r to get r dot as follows. Notice how we have an f dot there, which we can now replace with our result from the last slide. Now looking at this, we can see that these terms here cancel out. We can also replace 2 pi over p with n, where n is called the mean motion and really just represents the mean angular velocity. This gives us the following, which is equation 31 in the Correa and Murray chapter, but here we have derived it a little bit differently. Now let's pull that first r dot equation down here. If you look closely, you can hopefully see the r term inside of it, so making that as a replacement gives us the following, where I'm going to highlight the replaced r with a red box for clarity. We've got r multiplied by f dot together. Let's make those the subject as shown here. Next, let's replace the r dot term with the result above it, giving us the following. And here, these e sine f terms cancel, so simplifying everything down to just this. And this is the intermediate result that we're going to need. Now before continuing, make sure you can follow along with all of the mathematical steps there, all of the replacements and the differentiation we did. Now, it's not important or necessarily even particularly useful to memorize these derivations word for word. That's not important. But what is important is that you can follow along with everything that was done. Why? Well, these manipulations and gaining practice and doing them over and over again, it's like training a muscle. The more we do it, the more second nature it becomes to us. And my goal here as your teacher in these videos is not just to show you where these laws come from and these methods come from, but to equip you that you really could come up with your own new methods in the future to detect exoplanets, exomoons, rings, or whatever, using the principles of these manipulations that we've talked about. We're now ready to get velocity. Let's keep these two results and move them over to a new slide. we first note that v squared is going to be the self dot product of the r dot vector. Now, recalling our polar coordinate expansion for r dot, we have the following. And so using this to take the self product, it's just going to be the square of the two components added in quadrature. Let's take the common factor out as follows. We now notice a cosine squared and sine squared term that will add to unity to simplify this. Next, we're going to add plus 1 and minus 1 inside the bracket, which of course we're allowed to do, and that gives us this. And by comparison to our r equation, we can replace the 1 plus e cosine f term here with r. After doing so, we find a common 1 minus e squared factor that cancels out, giving us the following more simplified form. Now this looks like a lot of steps, but I'm really just breaking down all of the little steps often skipped over in this derivation. Finally, we can replace n squared a cubed using Kepler's third law to get our planetary velocity as follows. Now as a test of your understanding, I want you to take this equation and write down an expression for the velocity of a planet, but in the limit of a circular orbit. So just imagine that E equals zero and solve that equation. Now I want you to take that saved formula and compare it to a second completely independent way of getting the circular orbital velocity. Instead, this time I want you to do distance divided by time, where distance will be the circumference of a circle, and the time to complete the circumference will be the orbital period, P. Go through that, get your two formula, and see, do they agree? Okay, we have now obtained df dt and dr dt, but we haven't yet described a system for going from f to time. To do this, we need to write r dot in terms of just r so that we can solve the equation. Let's take these three results and move them over to a new slide. Now, by simple rearrangement, we can write r dot squared as follows. Notice how the terms on the right-hand side are things that we have solutions for now, so let's plug them in. Remember that what we're trying to do is to write everything in terms of r, so let's now recall Kepler's first law to replace the 1 plus e cos f term here. Similarly, I'm going to use Kepler's third law to switch from the masses to n squared a cubed. This gives us the following. Check you follow along. We can multiply out that bracket on the right to get this. And finally, taking a square root and pulling out the common factors, we get what we want, r dot in terms of r, no f's remaining. This is a differential equation that we can solve. Let's bring it over here. The fact that r appears in two places on the right makes this tricky to solve. So, to make progress, we'll do what we often do with such equations and make a substitution. Let's define a new angle, capital E, as the eccentric anomaly, defined as follows. As you can see in the top right, this has a geometrical interpretation. By imagining a circle of the same semi-major axis as the orbit, with E subtending an angle from the planet to the circle's center. So with that substitution, our equation for R becomes this, a bit simpler. And we can obtain r dot by differentiation. So using these in our differential equation, we get the following. And hopefully you can see that there are going to be some things which cancel out here. After making the cancellations, we get this. But that 1 minus cosine squared term is really just a sine squared term on the inside. So pulling that out, it cancels out with a left-hand sign. And so finally, we get this cute little equation in E. Now, we can actually just directly integrate that to give us the following equation for how E evolves with time. Taking the two results over to a new slide, let's look a bit more carefully at this. The T0 on the left is just a constant of integration. The term on the right-hand side, by comparison to the left, is just something which is proportional to time. Let's call that whole thing a new angle. Mean anomaly, capital M. That replacement also defines Kepler's equation, which relates mean anomaly and eccentric anomaly together. So that means altogether we have three angles describing a planet's position. We have first the true anomaly, F, that describes the angle subtended from the planet's position down to the star and back out to the periapsis position. That's F. Second, we have the eccentric anomaly, capital E, and that's really just a geometrical transformation of F. It's like stretching this orbit out a little bit. And then third, we have the mean anomaly angle, capital M, and that's really just defined to be linearly proportional to time. And these three angles together form a kind of holy trinity when we're trying to solve for orbital mechanics. Finally, we can now present a recipe for turning times into true anomalies. This is extremely valuable when modeling exoplanet orbits, and it sits inside almost all codes and software for detecting exoplanets. So here we go. Step one, we define mean anomaly as a simple linear function of time. Step two, we relate this mean anomaly to eccentric anomaly in order to solve for capital E. Now, unfortunately, this equation is transcendental, which means we can't analytically solve it. A popular numerical approach is to use Newton's method. Yes, as in Isaac Newton, that guy really does get around, which when we expand it out, gives the following recursive formula that converges very quickly. Now, step three, we take these eccentric anomalies and turn them into true anomalies using our geometrical relationship from before. This is usually done using the following more elegant equivalent expression. Now, we've run out of time today, but we'll actually go over some real computer code to do this soon. But already you have the steps here to do this for yourself. So having done all this, we can now make graphs and plot the relationship between all of these angles. You'll notice that for circular orbits, when little e equals zero, F equals capital E equals capital M, i.e. they're all just the same angle. But as we go to higher eccentricities, these lines diverge from one another. As an example, on the right-hand plot, look at that pink line, which is for E equals 0.9. We have mean anomaly on the x-axis here, which recall is a proxy for time. So you'll notice that the planet spends a lot of time at a true anomaly angle close to 180 degrees. F equals 180 corresponds to apoapsis, remember. In other words, if we imagine the planet's motion, it just kind of hangs around at apoapsis, barely moving, which is another way of stating a consequence of Kepler's second law. So that's it for today. That was a tricky one, so well done for making it to the end of this video, and also well done for making it to the end of the celestial mechanics section here. So now we have all of the pieces we need, in particular the 3D orbit and how to go from true anomalies to times. We now have all the pieces we need to actually think about exoplanet detection methods. And so in the next video, we're going to start a new section with radial velocities. How do we detect planets using that method? So hopefully I will see you there. Thank you so much for watching. And any questions, be sure to put them down below, and I'll try my best to get back to you.